Κυρίες και κύριοι, πολύ απλά, η κορυφαία Ελληνίδα αθλήτρια όλων των εποχών σε όλα τα σπορ. Πανίδη που από πλευράς τίτλων έχει κατακτήσει τα πάντα και πολλές φορές, πετάει και την αθροδέσμη.
You're a real inspiration to so many people because people feel your love for the sport and the fact that you think about everyone else and have perspective. Where do you get that from? Who was it and who inspired you and who were the people who have been key in your life to teaching you to be like that?
You know, I grew up in a very track and field family. Both my parents were on the national team. They were both very talented, so I grew up in that kind of a family where we always watched track and field. I truly think that at 6 or 7 years old, I started going to like track and field competitions at Worlds or even compete if they had for young kids. And so I grew up around that, and I think that alone, I think, raises respect for the sport. And it's actually funny because my coach many times says that I would have already broken the world record if I didn't respect the sport so much. But to me, it's really important. I grew up in a time where 460 was a great mark for women's pole vault. So for me, a few years ago, 460 was a huge mark still because it gave gold medals or medals at many major championships. So I think it definitely was my family and growing up into the sport that gave me this kind of respect for all the other athletes and the sport itself.
Yeah, nice competition anyway.
Katerina, what do you think?
I am 100% sure that Zimbayeva will compete in the Olympics. So I don't think that's going to be an issue.
You're sure she will be competing?
Yeah, I am 100% sure she will compete.
How can you be sure?
Well, I think, first of all, she has proved over many years that she is a clean athlete. And I think they will allow some athletes to compete. And I think she will be one of them. And she should be one of them. There's no reason why we should think that.
The problem is she was under control of the Russian protocols of anti-doping. So, and as you know, the anti-doping Russian was not.
I think she will compete.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
I know there hasn't been a decision yet. I know it's coming up, though, in a few days. But I just have this feeling that she will be in. However, it is very difficult for other athletes like Sidorova. For us, you know, she's one of the best. She's jumped 485 this year, and I think she deserves just as much to compete in the Olympics. but I think it will be much more difficult for her than
Yelena.
Now we've kind of put ourselves in a hole, and I'm not going to lie that I was surprised that Russia was not allowed to compete in the Summer Olympics.
I was kind of surprised too.
Right? Even like the day before the meet, I was like, no, they will be there tomorrow, you know? Like the day before our prelims, I really believe that they will compete. But I like the fight against doping. I think it's great. Don't know if it's the best way of doing just banning a whole country, just one country and the whole country.
Yeah.
No, I don't know. But I'm excited. I'm on the podium again. It's Angelica and Sandy jumped out of their minds, so I can quite be upset. I can be upset I didn't jump higher, but they jumped pretty high.
Well, I think now with Eliza and Nina not coming anymore, I think obviously my biggest rival will be Sandy. Sandy has already jumped a couple of times outdoors. She did really good at break. the last few years. She has been my biggest rival. So, and it's very fun. I very much enjoy the competition. I mean, not just with Sandy. I very much enjoy any competition. Whenever somebody can push me, I love that. And if somebody can beat me on my best day, I still love it. I feel like I did my best, and they pushed me. And some days, I was not the best, and that's okay with me.
I think now I'm up. I think it's 13 out of 13 wins in a row. So
phenomenal.
Yeah, I mean, it's very exciting. I was saying a year ago, I think I was telling you, I was seeing all these people have all these wins, and I was like, no way I can do that.
Now that you have accomplished all these goals, world champion, European champion, Olympic champion, are you finding it sort of easier to ride this wave of success? Or are you now feeling like, I have more pressure on me to sort of duplicate these things? Which one is it, or maybe a combination of both?
I think I would say a little bit of a combination. There's definitely more pressure, but I would say I'm an athlete that I like that. I think pressure is a privilege. I think
pressure is a privilege.
Yeah, you feel pressured because you've done good. People expect you to do good. You expect yourself to do good, and so I like it. There's definitely sometimes where there is. I don't want to say too much pressure, but there's definitely reaching the limits. But I think that it's a lot harder to come back from a bad year or many bad years in a row than it is to keep being successful. I think success is a much better motivator than failure is. I think it's great when people can come back from a bad year, but I think it's way more motivating to keep being good.
I have achieved everything I ever dreamt of, really, and I almost feel like I'm still here because I love pole vaulting and I love competing, but I feel a little bit like I'm now pole vaulting for a greater purpose, like to inspire young kids, especially coming from a small country like Greece, you know, inspire young kids. They can see that it doesn't matter what your background is, what your race is, where you're coming from, but you can achieve anything you dream and work for.
The fans are more knowledgeable. They appreciate the event a lot more. Of course, we could do a lot of things to grow the sport in places where it's not quite as appreciated yet, but
it seems like there's better ways to do things, but it is hard. And like I told you the other day, I think a little bit part of the problem is a lot of the big sports, like the NFL, the people that work for the NFL, or I want to think most of the people that do, are business people. They're not all football players. Look at IAAF. I mean, it's good to hire our own people, you know, it's good to help out our old athletes, but we need business people that will promote the event from a business perspective and not be emotional about it. Put us in the news again for the wrong reasons, and it was this great opportunity for all these sponsors to pull out, find holes in their contracts about doping and pull out. IAAF, there's so many Diamond Leagues. The Diamond Leagues that are the money-making meets for track athletes. Some of them don't have any sponsors anymore. The only money comes from IAAF.
You're so great. I think the whole stadium was up dancing, and this is exactly what we need in the sport right now. We need to engage the people. The people got excited. The people started knowing who I am, and not just me, but everybody. And I think everybody enjoyed it. It's really important. We need this in the sport right now to attract more people.
Like, so many steps that need to be, even what you were saying earlier about like people paying. I don't even want to pay to go watch that, you know? You know how boring it is to watch even pole vault, even when I know every single athlete in there, how boring it is to go and wait, and then you have to wait 5 minutes when there's one. Like, you know, it's not fun, and I know the athletes personally, and I'm personally invested in some of, you know what I mean?
Right.
So there needs to be change, and before we can charge people, we first need for people to come for free to the track meets. You know, we don't really have baseball in Greece, and I went to my first baseball game a year ago, maybe, and there was all these fun things that you can just walk around the stadium and do, and you don't have that at track meets. And I mean, even simple things, like Mitch and I always bet. Like, every jump, we will bet 5 push-ups. You know, just like the stupid things like this that make it a little more interesting, and I think it will be very easy to do it more officially, have real bets. I mean, I know it sounds stupid, but it's like horse racing, but it might be more interesting.
Well, yeah, I mean, they always say like stuff like even college basketball, what's huge about it is everybody does that bracket.
They do the
bets with the bracket, and that makes it popular.
It was just a few years ago that some people were saying, oh, a woman will never clear 16 feet, and now you have made it kind of part of your regimen. Do you believe that in your careers you'll see a woman clear 17 feet?
in our careers.
Or how about in your lifetime?
Well, definitely in our lifetime, I'd say. I think it's even possible that it will happen in our careers. I do think that that is closer to what women should be jumping, maybe. I think maybe we have treated women pole vaulters like women, and that they shouldn't grip on too big of a pole, or shouldn't grip that high, or shouldn't do this. And I think now, slowly, you're seeing the change. And I think that's why you're seeing more 16-foot vaulters. I think you're seeing different body types, right? Initially, there were all these gymnasts that were shorter and smaller, and now you have like Jen and like other people that are 6 feet tall. I'm not one of them, sadly, but it's okay. But I think a little bit the mentality of the event is changing, and I think soon there will be, I mean, I think there's people right now that should eventually jump 17 feet, but I think we'll see it, yeah.
This is a follow-up question for Katerina and Helen about the gender question that the gentleman was asking. the obligation to submit some of the athletes to a testosterone tests. How do you feel about that, Katerina and Helen?
I have my opinions about this, but I feel like maybe I don't need to express them because this is not affecting my event. I do think it's weird that it's not affecting my event. I find it hard to believe that if natural testosterone boosts performance in the 400, it doesn't boost it in the 2 or the 1 or the pole vault. But, I mean, I think that's all I'm going to say. It's not affecting the pole vault. I did read the study that they based it, or it seemed like they based this decision on, and it showed significant results for the pole vault. But I'm not quite sure how the decision was made. The only 2 field events that showed significant results was the pole vault and the hammer, but they were not included in the decision, and I'm not quite sure why not, or why the decision was made altogether.
The second most important thing in terms of coaching is for the coach to be adaptable. Me, that I grew up learning how to jump under the petrol for the Russian model, or whatever you want to call it, cannot be doing the same things as somebody who doesn't know how to jump quite as well or jumps very different technically. It has a So I think being adaptable, people should not be doing the same thing. Somebody might be really fast and need to work on their technique, and somebody might be really slow and be good technically and they need to work on their speed. And I think that's the one issue I have with college programs, is that everybody's doing the same workout. How is everybody doing the same workout? Like, it just doesn't make sense. Even if we all had the same issue and we all needed to get faster, the way I'll get faster is not the same way that you will get faster. You might need to run 200s and I might need to run 30s. So I think there needs to be more personalization when it comes to training at every level, from high school to college to elite and masters.
Sorry, can I add something to this? Because I've done this analysis before. If you see the second to last column where it says contact time to take off, it's how fast I got off the ground at the very end, and you can see that me and Yarisley Silva, who, if you've seen jump, sees extremely good at plyometrics. It jumps very high. And I think that contact to time, which for both me and Silva, it's a little longer, I think it almost correlates with power to the ground. So we're staying on the ground a little longer, but we're actually using the ground and jumping up. And I think that's something a lot of pole vaulters forget about. There is a vertical component to the vault. We want to run fast, but we want to run fast this way to go as high as we can. And I think a lot of vaulters forget that at the end of the day, we need to go up and we need to jump up and we need to help the pole. And I think this shows in that column, the contact time to take off.
Is that the same opinion?
No. We do like street meets, I think some of us more than others. I do think that, like Jen started to say, it becomes very tricky. And I don't think when they mean the conditions, they only mean the wind or the weather. I think there's starting to be an issue with the bounciness of the runway. And there is no rules, as far as I know, that measure that. So for all we know, we could put a trampoline at the end and jump off a trampoline. So I think there,
if we are going to have a lot more of those street meets, I think they need to be a lot more standardized, like tracks are. There's measurements for the track, for the hardness of the track. So I think there needs to be measurements for the hardness of the track of a runway and for the bounciness, because I think that changes the results in a major way, helps some girls and maybe hurts other girls depending on their style of running.
At the end of a competition, if you're tied for first place and there's only two people left in, and you fail your first attempt at 490 and your opponent clears 490, why do you almost inevitably go up to 495? Why don't you take your two extra jumps at 490 so you have three attempts at 495?
Well, at a championship, I would say that if there's only two people left, I will go up to the next height because I'm trying to win. Because even if my opponent made 490 and I missed, now I'm not tied for first anymore, I'm second. So I'm going up to the next height where I can go back to being first. But I think that's a personal thing. For me, I can only take so many jumps at a big championship, so I don't want to waste energy trying to jump a 490 and then go to the next height. But for somebody else who might be getting better by taking more jumps, maybe they will choose to take the extra two attempts at 490 and then move up. But to me, that wouldn't make too much sense, especially at a championship.
So at the end of the competition, your entire focus is on gambling, that just because you failed at 490, you are confident that you can make 495?
I think if I get the right jump that will make 490, it's quite possible that it might also make 495. So it almost seems like a waste to take a jump that might make 490 instead of trying the next height.
In college, we iced all the time. Ice baths, ice, this thing called game ready that we used to do that was just iced water, I think. I have come to realize that ice helps when there's an inflammation and you want blood to get out, but most of the times we want blood to come to the injured muscle or to the area. So I would say for probably 90% of injuries, I would recommend heating it and not icing it. And people might want to kill me for saying that, but I really, like, I'm a nerd. I went to Stanford and I read a lot and I read new research coming out. And I really do believe in the new research saying that ice can actually hurt you more. I think it really does slow down the healing process. And I think heating has really helped me a lot more than icing has.
But Katerina, you said something, or you tweeted something that really caught my attention after the after your event. And it was right after your interview. And you tweeted, "I'm not sure what goes through my mind during interviews." You gave a great interview. It was really wonderful, but that comment that you made, that you're not sure what goes through your mind during interviews, sort of tells me that you're tapping into some part of your unconscious mind as well when you're performing. So I'm wondering, are you doing any work on flow or the type of mind work that you're doing? Does it go to that place where you can tap that unconscious resource that you have?
I mean, I can talk about the unconscious. It's called the unconscious for a reason. But one thing that once we started working together, so let me first say that I studied psychology in college. Well, I studied biology and then I went into grad school. I got my master's in psychology. But when we first met, I was very against sports psychology. I think maybe because I saw how research was conducted, and to me, it just didn't seem applicable to what I would call the real world, and psychologists might kill me when I say that. But it's very different to have an experiment in a very controlled situation in a room, and very different what happens out there in the field. But he made me start doing a lot of visualization. It was very difficult for me at the beginning. I've done this now for 17 years, and I cannot visualize myself pole vault. I mean, I have to have taken now millions of jumps, and I was not able to visualize myself pole vault. So we started very slowly by maybe visualizing the first step and the second step, and at first I had to visualize myself from a third-person perspective, so as I'm looking at myself and not I'm actually doing it, and then slowly over the years, now I can say that maybe I've reached the point where I can see myself taking the jump from my perspective. It has been very difficult, but I think it's just as important as physical training. I think a lot of people know what to do for physical training. Even if you're not doing 100% the right things, you're close enough. As long as you're healthy, you can compete at a pretty high level if you're talented and you've done good work. But I think a lot of people forget about that part. They forget about the mental, well, it happens to be the topic today too, but they forget about the mental part. And that is something that Mitch really pushed me towards. But I think more to what you're saying about the unconscious, I think comes from the way my coach talks to me.
So many drills my first few years, and they actually didn't let me bend the pole for a couple of years too, so I would just straight pole. And I have to say so many good things about straight poling. It teaches you so much about the physics of the event. So I wouldn't say I would change too much. There was definitely some points I'd say that the Europeans take the technique part a little too far and forget about the speed and the power. But I was lucky enough to come to the US, where the other extreme exists, where you forget a little bit about the technique and just focus too much on the speed and power. And I think now, after so many years of doing one and then so many years of doing the other, I have found a good balance.